Good to be in God's house tonight, ain't it?
Yeah.
Had a good service this morning. Had a good crowd. We got a good crowd tonight, don't we? Amen. We had a good time at Brother Jim Burroughs' little retirement party, but he's not retiring from the gospel. He's just retiring from that church. God says, or Jesus says, pick up your cross and follow me daily. Sometimes picking up that cross means you got to do something different. He's spent 29 years, my whole life, in 1988 was when he took that church, and look what he's done with that church. You know what? Look what God's done through him at that church. That church is a big church. There's probably 150, 200 something people there today. Of course, some come from other churches there to celebrate this with him, but it just lets you know, hey, he's got a lot of ties, got a lot of roots there, but when God tells you to do something, you do it. Amen. Tonight I'm going to be talking about judgment. There's a judgment reserved for lost people. There's a judgment that's going to come for the lost. And we see it all through Revelations. There's a description of it all through the New Testament. Jesus speaks on it. Paul speaks on it. Disciples speak on it. Basically, folks, to make it plain and simple, you need to be saved. If you're lost tonight, you need to be saved. Now, y'all know I try to come out of the New Testament as much as I can, but I'm diving into the Old Testament more and more. So y'all bear with me. A lot of these kings' names and a lot of the details and all this stuff, I'm slowly learning. It's part of getting closer to God. It's part of learning the Bible is you got to stay in it. You've got to stay in it, and you got to try to understand it as best as you can. You got to pray before you read the Bible. Stay in the Word of God. So this week, I was listening to Revelations. Y'all heard me talk this morning. Daddy, me, and I told y'all, he told me some verses that I'd already read. Well, he also spoke about Abraham. Well, actually, Abram. Abram become Abraham later on. So I am learning a little bit. So we're going to be coming out of 2 Peter. I'm coming out of the New Testament again. I just said Old Testament. Well, we're going to go to the Old Testament in just a second. We're going to be coming out of 2 Peter 2, 4 through 7. And I like to keep my messages as simple as possible because I'm a simple man. I know y'all are simple people. And when I read the Word, I seen where Paul said that he didn't want to talk in words of such wisdom that exhorted himself. He wanted to talk of the Holy Spirit. And I believe that's as simple as possible. He just wanted to give his testimony. He wanted to preach the Word of God. He didn't want to use big words to confuse people to make himself look like he was such a knowledgeable man, even though he was a very knowledgeable man. He just wanted to preach the Word to where people can understand it and people can come to God. Let's not overcomplicate the Word of God. So we'll be coming out of 2 Peter 2, 4 through 7. And if your Bible's like mine up here, where it says before each thing in chapter 2, it says destruction for false teachers. Now we're going to see a lot of destruction for the lost folks. Folks, you got to be saved. If you're not, you can do it tonight. Destruction for false teachers. So verse 4 says, for if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment. Verse 5 says, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person and a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly. We go to verse 6 and it says, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes and condemn them with the overflow, making them an example unto those after should live ungodly. Y'all hear that? He destroyed it for those who live ungodly. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I'd like to thank you for today. I'd like to thank you for everybody that come out tonight, Lord, that chose to come out tonight and just praise you, Lord. I pray tonight that if we have something on us, if we have some problems, if we have some sin in our life, tonight is the night that we clean it up, Lord, and we start living for you. We pick up our cross and we start following you daily, Lord. I pray that you put the conviction of the Holy Spirit on us so strong that we make a move. We do something great. We speak up. We praise you. We raise our hands. We clap for you, Jesus. We start living for you, Jesus. I pray tonight that you just put that on them. Put it on our conscience, Lord, if we're not living right, Lord. If there's something that we don't even know that we're doing, Lord, put us on our conscience that we know that we need to start doing, not doing it, and we need to start doing right, Lord. Thank you for this church. Thank you for all that you do for me in my life, Lord, and I pray tonight if there is a lost person that tonight they make that bold, brave decision to ask you into their heart and they start living for you. In Jesus' sweet and holy name, and amen. So in 2 Peter, we just read that. Now if you jump back over here to Genesis chapter 13, I'm going to try to set the stage and I'm going to try to paint this picture of what happened of Lot and Abraham. Now Abram at the time, before he became Abraham. Obviously, God and him had a very close relationship, and they was traveling outside of Egypt. Abram and Lot. Lot was Abram's nephew, so they was traveling outside of Egypt. Now, these two men, it said they had exceedingly a lot of things. It said Abram was blessed with gold, with silver, with cattle. He had a lot. And with all this stuff, he had to have servants. He had to have herdmen. He had to have a lot of stuff to control all the things that he had. So that lets me know right there, you can be prosperous. You can have things and still be a man of God. Now, if we know that Jesus said it's hard for a man, a rich man, to go to heaven. It's almost as hard as they said a camel. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich man to enter to heaven. And the disciples, of course, if you see in there, they said, well, who can be saved? And he said, with men, things are impossible, but with Jesus, all things are possible. So yes, even a rich man can be saved. Amen. But Abram had a lot of stuff, and Lot was traveling with him. He had a lot of stuff. It described of him having a lot of cattle, had a lot of herds, had a lot of livestock. And as they're traveling out through here and they're over the land, it said the land was dwelled with all the things that they had. It was so much that the herdmen, it said there was strife between Abram's men and Lot's men. So they come to a crossroads right here. And Abram and him speaking, he said, I don't want there to be problems between me and you like there is between our herdmen. Let's just split up. He said, if you go to the left or go to the right, or you go to the north, go to the south, you go this way, I'll go that way. So if we go on down through it, in verse 12 it says, Abram dwelled in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelled in the city of the plains, the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent. Now keep that in mind. Pitched his tent toward Sodom. Now in verse 13 it lets us know right there that that was probably a bad choice for what Lot did. In verse 13 says, but the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly. And we'll go along about that here in a second. I believe that America's getting to that point of turning against God exceedingly. They're sinners before the Lord exceedingly. So y'all stay with me on tonight. I'm going to try to get this as best as I can because, folks, like I said, I'm just learning all this myself. So Abram, they decide he's going to dwell over here in Canaan. Lot said, I'm going to go over here. And he seen, that, I believe it said, the land of this area, the plains, was very lush. It was very prosperous. There's a lot of water over here by the Jordan River. He said, this is going to be a good spot for me to take all my stuff, and we can live here. But the problem is, he pitched his tent towards Sodom. Now, if we see Lot's wife, we'll get to what she did later on. So obviously, I think she liked Sodom a little bit. She may have had been a part of why he might have picked pitching his tent towards Sodom, because we'll see later on what she did, and obviously she liked the sin. That's the problem with people today, especially in America. We like coming to church on Sundays, but we also like looking over at the sin. We also like going to the get-togethers, the parties, the bars. Folks, I've been there. I've done that. I've been in that lifestyle in my early 20s. I was consumed by that. I was in church, but I was looking towards Sodom. It looked fun. It was fun going out there sometimes on the Friday and Saturday nights with your buddies, going out there to Chili's, going out there to little get-togethers. It was fun, but I'm telling you, folks, sin is fun in the moment, and even scriptures will tell you it's fun for a moment, but it can be devastating on your life. Sin will come back to haunt you. It will get you. It will put you down. And the Christian, you can't be living in sin, and you can't be happy. You're going to have to choose one or the other. One or the other is going to win out. And obviously, you see where God took me today. This won out over sin. I got out of it. You got to get away from it. You got to push it away. You can't put your tent towards Sodom. Remember, Lot put his tent towards Sodom, and we'll see what happens in his life later on, how sometimes where you dwell, what you do, where you go, who you hang out with, how it can be devastating on your Christian life. Amen. So we see them men here. He does this, they do that, they split up, they have a lot of stuff. He pitched his tent towards Sodom, and he went on. If we jump over here to verse chapter 19, we go on to see that Lot was in the city. He said he was in the gates of Sodom. Now there's Sodom, there's Gomorrah, there's other cities in this area, there's the plains of Jordan. It was a good, nice, remember that, it was a good, very vegetation, good farmer area in this whole area. So it said that he is inside of Sodom, inside the gates of Sodom, I believe. And then it says the two angels, let's see here. Let me find that real fast. There's angels that visited Lot. And it says in the first verse of chapter 19, and there came two angels of Sodom at evening. And Lot sat in the gate of Sodom. And Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them. Y'all heard me this morning. He rose up. And he bowed himself with his face toward the ground. And he said, Behold now, my lords, turn in, I pray you, into the servant's house, and tarry all night, and wash your feet, and ye shall rise up early and go your ways. And they said, Nay, but we will bide in the street all night. So Lot was trying to tell them, he already knew how bad these people are. And makes you think, why is he doing in the city of Sodom? He already knows how bad these people are. He already knows that he needs to get these men off the streets because he knows how bad the people of Sodom is. And obviously, if you look on down, you can read this tonight. I encourage you to read the Bible so you can back up anything that I'm saying. You can read for yourself and see what happens. He goes in there, he says, Get in my house. He takes these two angels into his house, and what happens? Here comes the men of the street. And this is where you'll hear about sodomy. You'll hear about homosexuality today in today's times. We refer back to this right here. These people, these men, wanted them angels, these men angels to come out. He said, We want them come out. We want to know them. Now, if you ever look in the word know, it wasn't they didn't want to meet them. Know means they wanted to have sexual relationships with these angels. That's what they wanted. And if you look on down, it says that Lot was telling them, Look, I do not want them to come out. I will even give you my daughters. He said, They know no man. I will give you them. Do as you please with them. So obviously Lot did fear the Lord that he was even going to give up his own daughters just to protect the angels. So the angels pulled him back in because they started to smoke Lot. They pulled him back in the door. They closed the door. And then obviously, if you read on down, I don't have the verses right here on me. I didn't circle them, but it did say that the angels blinded the men so they couldn't find the door to get in it. And as we continue the story, it said they said, Go find your brother, your son-in-laws. He went to his son-in-laws and said, Come, we got to flee the city. They're going to destroy the city. They're going to destroy this area. God is going to rain fire and brimstone on this area. We got to go. But it said his son-in-laws were kind of offended, thought that they was mocking the area. So if you look on, when you read this later tonight, I hope you do, or this week, you see that the son-in-laws didn't go with them. So obviously the son-in-laws liked the sin more than they liked God. And that's the problem today in America. That's the problem today in Henderson County. That's the problem today even in the house of worship when you see we got 50 here and we got 125. People like the world more than they like the Savior. And that's the problem. You got to get rid of that problem. You've got to start following Jesus. Like I said, you got to pick up your cross daily. Every day, you got to die for Christ daily. You got to start your day off in prayer. You got to start living for the Lord. You got to stay in this Word, because when you start reading this Word, it'll do more for you than anything that I can say, any preacher, the best preachers in the world. You read it, God will start talking to you personally, and you'll start seeing, hey, I do need to do more for God, when you see what some of these men in the Bible sacrificed. But continuing on, he tried to reason with his son-in-laws. They wouldn't come with him. So you just keep on reading. There's so much in there, folks. The next day they fled out, him, his daughters, and his wife. They fled out of that city because they knew it was about to come. And just to stop right there, Abram had a conversation with God before all this happened. They had a conversation, and he said, God, he said, if there's 50 people in Sodom, please spare them. If there are 50 righteous people in Sodom, spare the whole city. And God said, if there is 50 people there, I will spare them. There wasn't 50 people. Then he said, if there's just five less, he said, if there's 40 and five people there, spare righteous people. Remember that, righteous people in that city, spare them. Abraham's sitting here having a conversation. I believe even before that he said, why would you destroy the whole city if there's righteous there? How can you destroy righteous in the wicked? So here is Abram, a wonderful man of God, basically questioning God, saying, how can you do this? And God's saying, if you can find 50 people, if you can find 45 people, I will spare the whole city. He goes on down to believe 30. He goes on down to 20. Then he says finally, if there is 10 people in that city that is righteous, will you spare the city? And God said, if there is 10, I will spare that whole city, that whole area. Obviously, he didn't spare them. He couldn't find 10 people, but he did find something in Lot. He did find, that's why he sent the two angels there and got him out of there. And guess what happened? He destroyed the whole city. He destroyed the plain. He destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. He destroyed everything that inhabited into it. He even told Lot when he fled, he said, get into the mountains. I'm going to destroy the whole plains. You got to get out of there. You got to go. So guess what he did? He said he hastily got out of there. He went fast. He got out of there because he knew. Now here's the thing, and you remember his wife, when we start, it said he pitched his tent towards Sodom. And that's something that made me think, why would he pitch his tent toward Sodom? Because they lived in tents back then when they traveled. like I said, I think his wife might have had a little bit to do with it. Because as they are leaving, she looks back. Now, I know that is very symbolic. He told them, don't look back. His wife looked back at the city as it's being rained down by fire and brimstone. Why would she look back? Why would anybody look back? Why do you look back on your past? Why do you look back on sin? When you come up here and you pray to God to take a sin out of your life, why when you're halfway back to your seat, you look back at it and think, it's already in your mind. I just prayed to give up that, but I really don't want to give up that. I don't want to give up my drinking. I don't want to give up my partying. I don't want to give up the sin in my life because it's my little comfort sin. Give it up. Don't look back on it because it can be destructive on your life. She looked back. God turned her into a pillar of salt. So we see Lot here. When he chose where he was going to dwell, when he told where he was going to pitch his tent, where he said, where I'm going to live, that had devastation on his whole family. He lost his son-in-laws. He lost his wife because of where he chose to be. Maybe somebody today is choosing, you're in a situation, you're around people you don't need to be, you're hanging in places that you don't need to be. It could be destructive on your life. You could lose your wife. There's a lot of people my age, they get in divorces. It's just dropping off like flies. Howard Douglas, I'm sure a lot of y'all know him. He's a divorce lawyer in our area. He posts statuses joking all the time about people getting divorced. Our town, people get divorced all the time. I can name over 10 people who hasn't made it just a couple of years. Why? Because if you look at their Facebook pictures, they put it out there. It's not me judging. When you put your sin out there, people, you're not judging. You're just showing. When you live in bars, when you live in parties, it's not going to work. Devastation will happen. Adultery will happen. Something will happen. Sin, Satan can slip in that way right there. He comes in the back door. You've got to surround yourself by godly people. You've got to stay in fellowship with Jesus. You've got to stay in fellowship at church. You've got to pray. You've got to pick up your cross daily, and you won't have to worry about Satan. He can't get up on you because you've already got to stay.